WPFA.org and click the link at the top of the page. And thanks to all of you who have kept KPFA going strong for the last 66 years. It's 2 o'clock.
Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm Nurse Rona, and I'll be joining you twice a month to explore different concepts of health and well-being. I've been a registered nurse for almost 50 years, and for the last 30 years, I've been working with children and their families as a temperament specialist, parenting coach, and author. Today, we'll discuss how to be less busy, less stressed, and accomplish more while staying healthy. We'll talk about the stress response and the consequences it has on our health. Not long ago, today's guest, Dr. Christine Carter, who is a sociologist at UC Berkeley's Greater Good Science Center and a speaker, writer, and mother, found herself frustrated by the busyness of modern life. She had too many obligations and not enough time, energy, or patience to get everything done. Sound familiar? She tried prioritizing, multitasking, delegating, and even napping, but none really worked for her. After facing a series of illnesses, she became determined to create a less stressful life for herself without giving up her career success or happiness at home. She drew on her knowledge of the latest research related to happiness, productivity, and performance, and she followed strategies that promised to give her more energy and make her more efficient and creative. Her trials and errors are described in her new book, The Sweet Spot: How to Find Your Groove at Home and Work. Christine Carter, welcome to About Health.
Thank you for having me. I'm really happy to be here.
Yes, we've done some work together, haven't we?
Yes, it's great to see you.
Yeah, we did actually a bunch of podcasts called Happiness Matters, and actually they're still on my website at nurserona.com.
Uh-huh. They're still on the Greater Good Science Center website as well.
That's good. Well, I'm really excited about your book, and I thought it would be really helpful for our audience if you would start off telling us about how your health was impacted by the way you were working and caring for your kids. You were a single mom. You were writing, training, traveling. And I think your story is really important.
Yeah, well, you know, about 5 years ago, I had come through a really amicable but, of course, very difficult divorce. And I had a career that I loved. So I had situated my family in a way that I was really happy, and I was spending a lot of time with my kids, picking them up from school in the afternoons. And then I had three part-time jobs, basically, that added up to this wonderful career where I was speaking and writing a lot, and the executive director of the Greater Good Science Center at UC Berkeley, and doing a lot of coaching as well. And I really loved all of those pieces. So I was in this place where I really felt like I had it all. I had everything that I was really looking for, except perhaps for the thing that mattered most, which was my health. I was so tired, Rona. I was tired all the time.
I remember because your book, Raising Happiness, had really taken off.
And
you were really busy doing a lot of the tour on that. Yeah.
Yeah. It was really successful, and I was grateful for that, but that meant more speaking invitations. And, you know, I just was tired. I was exhausted. I caught every virus on every airplane I got on, and I started getting strep throat, which I was really prone to, but I got it, and it kind of runs in my family. It was like sort of this joke. We didn't see it as very serious because this is just something that we had, right? This was the weak link in the Carter lineage.
You were carriers of strep.
Yes, we carried strep throat. So I went down to visit my brother and left with strep throat, you know? So I got antibiotics, and then it went away, and it came back. And, you know, 18 months later, I had been through 9 courses of antibiotics, And it was actually Mother's Day. I will never forget. You know, to me, I was busy, but I wore that busyness as a mark of significance and success and productivity. Mm-hmm. It was like this mark of character, really, for me. It was I wore my exhaustion like a badge of honor.
Yes, and you and a lot of people.
Yeah, and so it was Mother's Day weekend, and I had been training with a close friend to run a half marathon that was a 5-hour drive away. I had my parents and my entire family. Family was down to watch me, and I woke up and I had 102 fever, and I ran it anyway.
Oh,
right? So this was like I was completely determined to press on.
And you were detached in a way from your own messages that your body was giving you.
I was aware that I was sick, but it wasn't that I was that detached. It was that I didn't want to disappoint the people who had driven 5 hours to see me on Mother's Day run this race. I was more concerned about other people than I was about myself and my own health.
And this is not unusual, particularly for women, I find.
Yeah.
And also for mothers.
Yeah.
Parents and professionals. And sometimes we do put ourselves last.
Yeah. I mean, I was determined to press on, even though I could kind of see the fall, right? I could see that I was not able to recover from this chronic strep throat, which was a joke in my family, not like a serious, you know, but I was starting to see that it was going to take more courage to recover than it would be to just, you know, do these things that were sort of hard. And I could hear myself, right? So I was telling stories about my health and my exhaustion that weren't totally true. Like, well, if I run, then my blood temperature will go up and it will kill off the infection.
Rationalization. Oh, right? Rationalization. Like, right.
You know, or I'll skip the big hill and, you know, or whatever. I just had all these things. Anyway, so that sort of went on. Nothing really came of that. I just continued to be sick. I had my tonsils out. It was a total ordeal. I had a very hard time recovering from that. And not long after that, I found myself with a very high fever because I had a kidney infection. So it was another routine infection. Not that kidney infections are routine, but urinary tract infections are very routine. And mine had I just had one, and I'd ignored it, and it just turned into this kidney infection.
And you were really sick.
I was in the hospital.
Yeah.
IV antibiotics. But it was this moment where I was like, oh, please give me IV antibiotics so that I can spend the night in the hospital.
So that's, you talk about that in your book, is like a hospital envy.
Fantasy. Yeah.
And, you know, I think it's really important to realize, again, how we often don't listen to the messages that our body's giving us.
No, until, I wasn't listening.
Until the crash comes.
Okay, well, listen, the crash wasn't even my health. It was that the doctor said, you cannot travel next week. And I had a really big speaking engagement in Atlanta. And it was a Sunday afternoon, and from the hospital sent an email to the conference organizers saying, I can't get on a plane because it could get into my blood, and could be really serious. And the conference organizers were so mad at me.
Mm.
I mean, they were not understanding about this at all, because I had put them in a really tough position, right? And so I understand that. But to me, the low point was not my poor health. It was the perfectionist in me disappointing people. It was hearing somebody say, this is going to impact your career. We are not going to hire you ever again. And we're going to tell everyone. Now, I will say that was 5 years ago, and they have hired me since.
Right.
But I did recover.
The message there is you're not important.
Yeah.
The fact that you're very sick, the fact that you're in the hospital is not important. And it's just another example of the value that the message out there in our society is that be busy. Be productive, be even busier, push through it, and don't stop and take care of yourself. I mean, having a lot of antibiotics isn't good for you, you know, having a kidney infection. So something happened for you where you had a wake-up call.
So that was my wake-up call, right? So I realized the irony of it. I was supposed to be going to talk about how to lead a more balanced, happy life, right? How to raise happy kids. And I was getting tons of advice from everybody around me all the time. You have to slow down. alone. You can't have it all. That was the message. And I just kept thinking, you know what? Every part of my life is so hard won. I can. If I can't figure this out, nobody can. You know, I'd been studying productivity and elite performance and happiness for more than a decade at that point. I knew I had the tools.
Right.
I just wasn't walking the talk.
And it's really important. And for those of you who are listening today, at any point, you can give us a call at 510-848-4425 or 1-800-958-9008. You know, we're going to talk about more now about managing stress and managing that feeling of being overwhelmed and really, in a sense, out of control of your own life.
Right, right.
And I think what you bring, Christine, to the table is some real science behind the strategies that you talk about in your book, The Sweet Spot, of things that you can do so mm-hmm. that you can still be passionate about the work you're passionate
yeah.
about and love your family. And I think that when I've heard you speak recently, you really stress the idea that being busy is not something to be proud of.
No, like I was. Right.
It's really unhealthy for us.
Yeah. So this is the great cultural lie that busyness is a sign of success or significance or importance.
Yeah.
Right. And that it's actually not true. If you think about when we say that we're busy, well, first of all, we know intuitively it's not true when you stop and think about it, because we all know incredible people who are doing incredibly significant important things in the world who aren't busy, right? They aren't overwhelmed. And the reverse is probably even more true. We know tons of busy, overwhelmed people who aren't particularly productive or successful.
Or healthy. You know, it's interesting. As you're speaking, I remember living in Africa. I lived in the Congo
for
a couple of years. I learned so much there. But one of the things I learned there was that people took a break in the middle of the day, which is true for a lot of countries other than the
right.
United States. And everything shut down, you know, in the
mm-hmm.
afternoon. And I was just so shocked by it. I had never experienced that before. I hadn't been out of the country before. And people weren't, you know, proud of the busyness. They knew they needed that rest.
Mm-hmm.
They needed to refuel.
Mm-hmm.
And then, of course, they'd stay up later and eat later, but they were so much happier after taking that midday. And I'm thinking a lot about parents also who pretty much, if they're listening now, might say, yeah, but I am busy. I can't manage it all. I'm juggling all the time between, you know, rushing off to work and then picking up my kids. And so I'd like to get into now some of the things
that
your book and you suggest, where to start when you're noticing that your life isn't working for you, as you did with yours.
So I think the first place to start is to recognize that busyness is not a sign of productivity. It's a sign of overwhelm, or what researchers tend to call cognitive overload. So cognitive overload happens when we start to feel busy and overwhelmed, and it makes it really hard for us to think clearly, to plan, to stay organized. It impairs our decision making. It makes it hard for us to resist temptation and not behave impulsively. Makes it really hard for us to control our emotions, for example. It makes it hard for us to recall social information. So if we're working in a team environment or with our kids at home or whatever, it's hard for us to remember our daughter's best friend's name or our boss's daughter's name or something like that, right? So it really makes it hard for us to work well.
So this is cognitive overload,
yes.
Which is what people experience daily.
Right. Oh, yeah. Absolutely, right? So when we say, you know, I'm feeling busy, the first step is to recognize that sense of overwhelm is making it hard for you to do all those things that you do, and that this is totally normal. We human beings are not computers. We actually can't multitask. We don't. We just switch really rapidly between activities. That causes stress and tension and error. So it is sort of this difficult situation that we're in. The first step is to step back and see it for what it is.
Notice it. Here I am. Like I'm spinning.
I'm feeling overwhelmed. That sense of overwhelm or that cognitive overload is making it harder for me to do what I need to do. And then to take a break, right? So to slow down, let yourself do one thing at a time.
Well, that's a good place to pause for a minute. And I think no matter what you're dealing with, you know, when I work with parents who are feeling overwhelmed or they're yelling at their mm-hmm. kids or they're dealing, it's always about observing and then stopping. And for mm-hmm. me, it's always about taking a breath.
Yeah.
So that I can come back to some kind of grounding. I'm going to open up the phone lines now, 1-800-958-9008 or 510-848-4425. Let's take a call from Catherine. Hello, Catherine.
Hello.
Hi, you're calling from Sebastopol, it looks like.
Yeah, hi. I can so relate. I have an autistic child. She's now 25, and I had 40 doctors in 2 years, 70 volunteers in 2 years. 4 math programs in 1 year, and, you know, then as I got older, I just felt like I was really exhausting every resource I had to help my family. We moved 30 times in 25 years.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, and, you know, it's amazing what you do.
Yeah.
And she taught me a lot. I went through a lot of environmental medicine for her. And she did really well. And then I started getting infections, and I too was on 20 rounds of antibiotics in 2 years, and my system totally crashed, and I've dealt with strep for a year. And
how did you turn things around for yourself, Catherine?
You know, I'm very fortunate that I met in many of the doctors that I've worked with for my daughter, this doctor who treats with frequency medicine. And she started treating me, and I started dropping a lot of things that were kind of hurting me. You know, drinking caffeine, smoking, mm-hmm. any alcohol, mm-hmm. no sugar,
mm-hmm.
Watching my diet, bone mm-hmm. broth, gluten-free grains,
mm-hmm.
Just really sleeping.
Sleeping,
and
yes.
Paying attention. And paying attention to my hormones, because as I'm in my early 50s, I can't throttle my body like I did in my 30s and 40s. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely right. It really changes over time, and it sounds like you were able to find some help with lifestyle changes that mm-hmm. really mattered. Do you have a question for Christine, or did you just want to let us know about how much you relate to this?
Well, I do relate, and, you know, it's been really hard, and I actually discovered I had Lyme underneath it all, so that was a big discovery, and I'm treating that, too, and I'm really doing well. And maybe that was my issue, because I'm having a hard time turning everything around despite superhuman efforts to try to help myself. How did you turn it around, like, with the antibiotics, you know, strep, you know, exhaustion? I mean, you've got to have replenished your body significantly mm-hmm. to overcome that.
Yeah, great question. And Catherine, if you get a chance sometime, I'm at nurserona.com. Send me an email. I want to do a show on Lyme at some point. So if you have any good resources, send me some emails. I'd like to hear of who you work with. But Christine, how did you get healthy?
Well, I had to sleep a lot, and I had to change my diet and do all kinds of things. But before I could really do any of that, I had to sort of free up the time to sleep more and to take better care of myself. And so I did a couple of things in order to do that. I was very determined not to give up time with my kids and, you know, to do things that would hinder the career that I'd worked so hard for. However, I did start giving up things I dreaded doing. So the first thing I did was I started noticing, you know, what activities did I really want to do, and what activities were seeming to take more energy than others, right? And noticing that some things you can do really easily. So the sweet spot, the title of my book comes from this concept. If you can imagine a Venn diagram, those things that you find really easy, it doesn't really take any energy at all, right? And the places where you have particular strength or personal power, right? The overlap between those two things. So I was living my life from a place of strength, for sure, but outside of that realm of ease. So I kind of came at it a couple of ways. One, I just started eliminating the things that I just felt too hard, that I dreaded doing, that I was doing because I felt like I should do them, right?
Give us an example.
Well, you know, the biggest example was that I stepped down as the executive director of the Greater Good Science Center. I love the organization. I'm still affiliated with the organization. I didn't give up any part of my job that I loved, right? The things I looked forward to, which was mostly writing. You know, I am a writer at heart and a sociologist. So
You didn't want to run.
No, I really didn't want to do the administrative. Yeah. Piece of it, but I was doing it because it was prestigious, because I loved my colleagues, because I didn't want to let anybody down, because, you know, there were a lot of reasons I felt like I should do it, and I had a lot of fear about not doing it, but in the end I was able to give up something that didn't bring me any joy, and so it didn't feel like I gave up anything at all, right? There are other things, like homework was always a particular battle, but I felt like I should be the one constantly staying on track with my kids, even when they were at their dad's house. You know, I would help them with their homework, and I, you know, felt like they needed one person to keep them on track, the whole thing. And then it occurred to me, this is something I really dread doing.
Uh-huh.
Maybe they do need one person. Maybe it's not me. Right?
Reevaluating the things that gave you a little bit of that kind of tight stomach, or saying, I dread this.
And, you know, that's the perfect way to phrase it, too, because I really was paying attention in my body to it. Because, you know, my body was screaming at me, right? This is, something is wrong. I can't heal myself. And it turned out I already knew what things I should, quote unquote, do and shouldn't for my body. And so I have people, you know, if you don't really feel in touch with the sort of subtlety of whether or not something is good for you to do, is, you know, in your highest interest to do, I promise you, your body knows. And to just practice. So saying things out loud, like, you know, I sure do like to throw up. Like, that's not true, right? And your body will, I actually can feel it, right? I can feel it the way it feels on my skin when I just say that. For me, it registers mostly in my stomach and my skin, but for different people. Even doing this with my daughter, I'll have her stand up and then she'll say something really true. You know, I love baby Max. It's her cousin, right? You know, and she'll say, I love baby Max. And she'll sort of lean forward, right? And then, I love to be carsick. Not true. She'll sort of start lean backward. So our bodies will tell us, and we just have to figure out how.
We have to figure out how to listen to it. And then I think there's this whole identity piece, you know, that we have our identity hooked into the kind of person we are.
Yeah, it's so true.
The kind of person we become, you know, and we have to be willing to let go of that image in order to be healthier. So there are parents who always say yes at the PTA meetings and take on a lot. And it's wonderful that you parents are out there who say yes at the PTA meetings. But the truth is, sometimes you have to learn how to say no. And I think you've talked about that
a lot.
Both of your books.
Yeah.
That, you know, there are some basic things we can't say no to. We have to feed our children and go to work to make money. But I think I want to keep talking about the kinds of things you suggest in your book that reduce that. I think it's that level of cortisol that's running through our bodies, and maybe you can talk a little bit about the science of that for our listeners. And again, I'd love, thank you for Catherine calling, and I'd love to hear from anyone who has figured out how to have a less stressful life without having to give up the things they need to do in order to function well. And again, the number is 848-4425.
Yeah, definitely. I think saying no is a huge piece of this. It's also saying yes, right? So one of the things that people don't, I think, always understand about the stress response in our system, you know, if we feel even low-level threat or that sense of overwhelm. We can go into a state of fight or flight. And I think we know a lot, actually, about that fight or flight piece of things. What people don't realize is that our positive emotions, a sense of gratitude or play or happiness, we can talk about what they are in a second, they function physiologically in our body to put the brakes on that stress response. So for me, it wasn't just about learning how to say no and having the courage to do it in the places where I could see that I dreaded, but it was also really embracing the big yes in things. There were things that I really love doing. I really like writing. It is not torturous for me like it is for a lot of people. And to give myself permission to do this thing that brings joy into my life was not just filling my life with an activity that doesn't cause stress. It was actually helping me recover from the things in my life that do bring stress. So, we talked a little bit about your time living in Congo. I lived in Spain for a while. There is this, the other cultures have this sense of, you know, we take breaks, we play, we do things just for the sheer joy of doing them. Do we hang out with each other? For me, I had to sort of, start to incorporate those things. Take breaks, mm-hmm. right? And go outside and throw the ball for my dog. Not because I have to, because he needs it, but because I think it's funny, right? I think it's hilarious. I think it's fun to watch. It brings this sort of sense of joy into my life.
And taking recess is one of the things you talk about in your book as one of the things people don't do in our culture.
Right.
And they don't take that little recess. And recess doesn't mean getting the laundry done.
No. Recess does not mean getting the laundry done. That's part of our work that we need to do. And the way our human brains work the best is when we focus on our work for 40 minutes, maybe an hour, if you're really in the flow, some people can go to 90 minutes. But for me, I just try and aim for 40 minutes. And if I'm going, I let myself go a little bit longer. And then really go back to the sort of old-fashioned school concept of recess. What you're doing is giving yourself a break and going outside and playing or, sitting and gossiping with a friend.
Or daydreaming.
Or staring into space, right? For this is a really big one. We don't do these things because they don't feel productive. And if we're not productive, if we're not busy all the time, then it's the opposite of busyness, right? We feel insignificant. We feel unproductive, unsuccessful. All of a sudden we think, oh my gosh, I'm being lazy.
Isn't it? It's so true. There's the culture of, sitting there sometimes, I even feel it myself. Like, what am I supposed to be doing? And yet I could think back to being a child and just picturing sort of looking at the light and going outside. But there is built into our conditioning, what should we be doing right now?
Okay, so here's the thing. The reason that we feel unproductive and insignificant when we're not busy or when we're just taking a break staring into space is because we think nothing is happening in our brain that is productive.
But there is.
If we're trying to live and work from our sweet spot where we have great ease and great power, we need creativity and insight. Yeah. And guess what? When you stop focusing on a task, when you're not checking your email, and you're not checking something off of a to-do list, it feels like nothing's happening in your brain. Actually, in the unconscious part of your brain, a different attentional network becomes very active.
Yes.
And that part of your brain that becomes active is responsible for creative insight.
I think that's such an important point. And before the drought, I found that I could take showers.
Yeah.
And, here in California, we really have to be mindful of how we use water. But that's when I found some really great creative ideas would come, because in a way, I had turned off that productive part of my brain.
Well, this is the only productive place. I mean, it's a cliche. Where did you get that idea? In the shower.
Right.
Right?
But it's true.
It's completely true. And it's the only protected part of our world anymore that, and somebody was like, I've got this. I just found the greatest thing. They're waterproof Post-its. So the ideas you get in the shower, I said, no, we're not going to do that. Right? Mm-hmm. I get that your best ideas come to you in the shower.
But
trust yourself
to
remember it, because once you bring a pen in into the shower, you're working, right?
You switch it all off. Let's take some more calls. We have Cindy from Palo Alto joining us. Good afternoon, Cindy.
Hi. Thank you for bringing up this topic.
You're welcome.
My comment has to do with something I learned and when I was ill, and then we used with patients at Stanford Hospital later, and it's really easy to integrate into everything you're doing. And like if you're driving or if you're waiting in line at the grocery, various circumstances where you find yourself during the day. And it's called Jinshin Jutsu. It's an ancient healing art from Japan that helps the body to exhale or bring us back to the smile. And it's a real easy little acronym to remember. The tricks is stop, worry, fast.
Stop and what? Stop.
Stop, worry, fast.
Stop, worry, fast. Uh-huh.
Right. And what we're going to do is we're going to work through the fingers on the hand and the thumb. We're going to hug each finger. You can hug the thumb if you feel worried. You can, and then, so that's the worry. So you put up your hand like a policeman's hand, like, stop.
Yeah.
And then worry is the thumb. The index finger is for fear. So if you feel scared or fearful, hold your index finger. Anger is the middle finger.
Sure is.
And sad. If you feel sad, you can hold your ring finger. And if you feel like you're just trying and trying and trying and things just aren't shifting, you can hold your little finger, so that's called trying. So that's fast.
Wonderful.
Sad is trying.
So it's stop, worry, fast. It's Jinshin Jutsu. And I think what it reminds me of, too, is sometimes when I take some breaths and then you do gentle acupressure on my hands, it changes something. Christine, you want to?
What I love about this, I've never heard of this, but I love it, and I'm going to teach this from here. So thank you for bringing this to our attention. And because I'm always trying to teach people how to just feel what it is they're feeling. And this is a particular problem today in our need to be busy all the time. So we're waiting in line at the grocery or at the bank or wherever, you know, or just at a red light, right, in the car. And feelings come up, right? We might have worry or
fear,
anger, what is it?
Sadness
or trying, right? Or just anxiety that we're not busy, right? Or guilt that we're not busy.
Or thinking about what's coming ahead that we're worried about.
Right. And what do? We pull out the computer in our pockets, right?
That
we, our smartphones,
which,
and we check our email, right? We don't let ourselves feel what it is that we're feeling. We stay really busy. Now, it's effective, actually. It's a very effective numbing behavior, right? You feel anxious that you're not busy, or you are having some other difficult emotion, and so you check your email or your Facebook feed or whatever you can access on your phone, which is virtually everything, and that numbs those feelings, those difficult feelings. Now, the problem with this is that you don't get to selectively numb emotions in your life. So when you numb the anger that you're feeling about some injustice, that you also are numbing the profound gratitude that might have come in the next minute or so, or a sense of delight or
the real grief or a grief that you feel that you actually need to feel in order to pass through it.
Right. So, you know, Louis C.K. has a very hilarious riff about this. And basically what he says is, you know, when we're checking our phones all the time and when we don't let ourselves just feel the sadness that sometimes comes in life, you know, he says we don't ever really feel sad, but we don't also really ever feel happy. We just feel sort of satisfied with our product, and then we die, right? It's this numbing.
I love it.
Right? So so what I really appreciate about this technique that you've brought to us is that it gives us a very concrete practice for how to just let ourselves feel what we feel so that we can move through that and then really have some stillness, right? So we can just eventually wait in line at the grocery store and let our minds wander. When our minds wander, we'll be more creative. That will give us more power when we go back to getting something done.
Yes, and Christine, you know, the research also shows the folks at 6seconds.org, you know, they talk about that after taking some easy breaths, which would happen when you're doing this ginseng jitsu, you know, with your fingers, you start to bring down also your stress hormones.
Right.
So then you can feel what you're feeling, but somehow you're grounded in a very different way.
Right.
So I appreciate that. Thank you so much for the call, Cindy. Let's take another call. We're talking.
Am I gone?
Oh, I think you're gone, though. But no, you are. You can't be gone. I just heard your voice.
I like it.
I just want to give people some resources online if they're interested.
Sure. Go ahead, Cindy.
There's videos and all kinds of papers. We have a PubMed paper. It's 21stcenturymed.org. 21stcenturymed.org.
Wonderful.
There's all kinds of stuff on there, whether you're just a person or a kid or a health practitioner.
Great. 21stcenturymed.org. Thank you for what you shared with us and the resources. I appreciate your call so much. We're talking with Christine Carter from the Greater Good Science Center. Her new book is called The Sweet Spot, How to Find Your Groove at Home and Work. Let's take Chris from San Francisco. Thanks for waiting, Chris.
Hi. I just want to thank you so much for this show. I'm such a huge fan of Christine's and the center. What your last caller just said has been, it's really resonated with me. When I made the breath my go-to response, that's when things really started to get manageable. My question is, can you speak to the physiology, the biological benefit, the incredible mental, emotional, cognitive benefit of exercise?
Of exercise. And is that something you're personally aware of yourself?
Yes. And it's been my greatest resource.
Yeah.
I would have to say.
Good. Well, you know, I noticed too, and we'll ask Christine a little bit more about the research and the science, but I notice I go to the Berkeley Y most mornings. I love it. It's one of my joys in life. And I don't work out hard, but I just, you know, do some gentle exercise. And what I notice about me is I feel like I've pressed a reset button.
Mm-hmm.
I feel my circulation going. I feel my brain clearing. I feel the aches and pains disappearing, and it brings me a sense of real hope and joy for the day. So I think there's so many experiences that people have with, in a sense, clearing their mind when they exercise.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And maybe you can respond to Chris.
Yeah, I mean, I think I have a couple of things to say about this. The first is that the science around the incredible benefits of exercise, you know, especially moderate exercise, but consistent, are well known, right? It from a happiness standpoint, from a stress reduction, from health, from cognition in terms of improving your intellectual ability. This is something that we want to do if we want to optimize our brain in a way that we can live and work from our sweet spot, if we want to optimize the amount of happiness we have. I think we get that. The disconnect for most people is just how? How do we do this? I know I should exercise.
I don't have time. I'm too busy.
It's sort of hard. I'm too busy to do it. Right. So for me, this is something that I really grappled with as a, you know, former marathon runner type. You know, I was always hurt and I was always really struggling. You know, I would set really big goals and make really elaborate plans. And I could not have possibly been more in tune with the benefits of exercise, but I just couldn't quite get it done in a very mm-hmm. consistent way. So I kind of ended up doing an exercise overhaul, which started with the sense that I felt very weak and I wanted to do some strength training. And after, you know, gyms and personal trainers and online plans and apps and everything, in the end, I just said, you know what, I'm going to do something that I can do every single day.
Uh-huh.
And so
manageable.
Yeah. It was my better than nothing workout plan. I do it in my pajamas most mornings, since occasionally I'll get dressed first, but mostly I just do it in my pajamas now. I do 20 push-ups. I do a minute and a half plank, and I do a minute or a minute and a half wall sit or a bunch of squats. So I can do that in 3 minutes, right, or 4 minutes, right, if I'm really ambitious. And to my former self, this was something that was pathetically unambitious. But I am much stronger now. Mm-hmm. than I've ever been. So
Because it's consistent.
I can do it when I'm traveling. I can do it when I don't particularly feel well. I mean, I'm healthy now, but yeah. There are still mornings I wake up tired and don't want to exercise. I can still do that better than nothing.
And you've made it a habit.
It's totally a habit, right? That which is brings in that ease piece of things. But, you know, so it's not the only exercise that I do, but every exercise that I do throughout my day has this sort of really easy, unambitious component to it.
And it makes me think, Chris, that sometime we'll do a show, perhaps, about exercise and sort of the research around it, because I think it's complicated. And I know that one of the key things people say is you got to find something you like.
Yeah.
All the research in the world won't help you if you're not enjoying the exercise.
That's that joy piece of things.
Yeah.
Or just lowering the resistance. So don't try and do so much. So I actually don't like doing push-ups. I actually actively really don't like doing push-ups.
Yeah.
But so you pair it with something you do like, right? So I like listening to books on tape. And as I'm going through my sort of morning, and I don't listen to TED Talks, even though I like doing that, if that's too ambitious, right? I listen to fiction, easy fiction. You know,
so
I mean, I'm not
pleasure.
Ambitious.
Yeah, right.
It's pleasure with the push-ups.
Yeah, good. Thank you for your call, Chris.
Thank you. And I just want to say that, you got to enjoy it. I have actually fired push-ups. and what I had to do, I recently completed graduate school, and I just had to make going for a bike ride as legitimate as doing more research or writing another paper or showing up for class.
Which it is in terms of optimizing your brain, right?
That's right.
So if what you want is to improve not just the amount of work you can get done in a given period of time, but also the quality of your work, then it's really important to get that exercise. Yeah.
And I think that's what the research shows, and that's what you talk about in your book, is to see it as just as valuable for your health and well-being.
As non-negotiable.
As non-negotiable. Great. Let's move on. Thanks, Chris. And we'll take a call now from Leif. I think it's Leif in Berkeley.
Hi, thank you for taking my call.
You're welcome.
I got two things to say. One, something's practical, physical, and then first I want to say before that is I work for myself most of my life because of a minor disability, and I'm 56. And I just want to hone in a little bit on what your guest said. About social pressure, I don't feel that. And I see a lot of people around who I know, mainly self-employed people, I don't feel any culture pressure to do more and not take free time. I feel the pressure when I need to pay my bills.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Thank you for mentioning that.
Yes, I don't really see that there. And when I go out and they see someone else is busy, they look stupid to me.
Uh-huh.
So I don't, and I have a whole lot of friends around, a lot of people in my neighborhood who really, I don't really see that there's that cultural pressure.
Well, that, I mean, again, it depends on where you are, the people you're with, and it's good that you've come to that. But you're bringing up the point that at the same time, you might have stress from the issues of being able to have the money you need.
Right. So, and then as far as work is, I get to my job when I think it's best for me to get the job. I organize things ahead of time. And I'm not feeling like at any time, including when I'm doing laundry, that it's work and it's taking me from recess. That is, I've been working my entire life since before I graduated high school in doing things that I enjoy to do.
That's great. That's
so
awesome.
I don't really...
Yeah,
and
you have the Zen approach to things.
Right. And so the practical comment I want to say is, and I learned this from the movie a long time ago, well, I already knew it to some extent, but reiterated in What the Bleep Do We Know, which was about the hypothalamus and how, let's say, I have a someone scares me or I have happiness or whatever it is, all emotions are felt physically. If you didn't have a physical response, you wouldn't know you had an emotion, because the hypothalamus within 1.5 seconds dumps peptides on the receptors of all the cells in your body. In a case of fear, the receptors are more for that in your stomach and in your breath, in your lungs, and they react to peptides. So it does that every 8.5 seconds, depending on what's happening. So if you can pause, let's say you're suddenly upset. Someone scares you. Someone threatened me yesterday, for example. Or at say something really, whatever. You just pause for 10 seconds, more than 8.5 seconds, and that emotion will subside.
Well, I think that's really interesting for people to consider and to try. No matter what the science is behind it, your experience shows you that something shifts physiologically when you take that pause and you take that 10 seconds. Christine, anything you want to add to what our listener is speaking about?
I think he's actually going back to what the previous caller was saying, or a couple callers ago, and having sort of not just the rationale, but the technique of stopping and feeling whatever it is that you're feeling. You know, we know that the emotion will tend to keep popping up for you if you numb it out or you tamp it down or deny it. But if you just are there and let yourself feel it, the emotion does tend to dissipate. Now, there's an interesting little irony here in that is that if you're listening to how you're feeling, if you're noticing how you feel, in order to get rid of the emotion, it's a form of resistance that makes it less effective to do, right, in terms of getting rid of the emotion. So I'm not being very articulate here, but a lot of times we just need to feel how we're feeling and accept how we're
feeling.
That's what I was
going to say. It's
without
trying
to get rid of it, right? When you're resisting, when you do something to try and get rid of it, it's a form of resistance that then your body notices and it tends to not clear from your system.
Well,
it's just acceptance.
I find that really helps me to actually be able to say, okay, I'm starting to feel resentful right now.
Mm-hmm.
And then breathe into that and feel it. And then give it a moment to see if there's anything I need to learn from that feeling.
Right.
And I think that's part of the whole practice of mindfulness is not to feel like I've got to change it. But I think what our caller said, which is really true for me, is the key element is giving it a little time
mm-hmm.
and giving it a pause,
mm-hmm.
however you want to deal with what's going on. But I think when we try and push those emotions away, they seem to keep popping up all over. Leif, I'm going to take another call. Thank you so much for participating and adding your wisdom. We have Noemi. Is it Noemi in San Francisco?
Thank you.
Yes, hi.
Thank you. And thank you for your show.
You're welcome.
I really appreciate the show, and everything you say resonates with me. I want to talk about one of the things that doesn't come into talking about how people are busy in the world is the idea that we are all with the same type of body. And what I mean by that is I have cerebral palsy, but I have a mild case, and I'm totally mobile. I walk every day. But I find because of the pressure, and it's interesting, the man before me talked about not feeling the pressure.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But I do.
Hmm.
Because what I hear is not from you, but from society, is that all our bodies are the same.
Oh, you hear from society that all our bodies are the same, and you're trying to really help us understand that that's not true.
That is not true. So we all function differently.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something that I haven't heard as part of the conversation.
Great.
Of wellness. And I would like you to address that.
Yes, yeah. And I really appreciate you calling because, you know, because you have cerebral palsy, you have a very different experience than I have based on, you know, what my limitations are, what your limitations are, what my strengths are, what your strengths are. And we do have to know our own body.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And that all the science in the world, you know, can inform us, but it's not going to inform us in the same way as our own understanding of our own body. And I think going back to how Christine started her discussion here is that her body was giving her lots of messages mm-hmm. that she wasn't necessarily paying attention to.
Mm-hmm.
And
that my body was different, not just from the people around me, but that different than it had been 10 years earlier.
Right.
Too, you know, like that our physical yes. bodies are different from each other, but also from what we, mostly from our expectations.
Exactly.
Of what they will be able to do. And that when we don't acknowledge that we have all of these differences.
Right. I just turned 58 and I know my body is different than when I was 30. Yeah,
absolutely.
that's, everybody's like that, but I think having cerebral palsy, cerebral palsy is not so-called progressive,
yes.
but yet it does have an impact. Age and cerebral palsy do interact together.
Yeah. You know, the other thing that I want to say about this that I think is so interesting, I think you're raising really good points, is that we don't just have expectations for ourselves, but we also have expectations for other people. And we imagine yes. the yes. expectations that other people have for us.
Yes.
And that's where, at least in my experience, a lot of the pressure was coming from. It wasn't from the actual expectations other people had for me. Nobody in my family expected me to run having a 102 degree fever,
yeah.
right? But I imagined that it yeah. would be annoying to everybody else. It's not just managing the expectations of other people. It's more about paying attention to what is.
Yes.
What is yes. happening with our body.
And accepting it and not being ashamed of it and yeah. feeling like we're okay as we are.
Right.
And so thank you so much for bringing
yeah.
this up.
I
hope, you know, when I do shows in the future, you'll certainly make sure if I leave something out that you'll call and tell me, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And, you know, Christine, also in your book, we haven't gotten to that part yet, but I just want to mention it before we run out of time, is you have a whole section on relationships.
Mm-hmm.
And I was thinking a lot about that because so much of my well-being and my happiness, also my angst, mm-hmm. comes in relationship to others. And as I get older and I think about my life, I realize that's also what brings me the greatest joy. But I appreciate that in your book you're talking about sort of the rupture of relationships and how important they are in this whole picture. So just very briefly, if you want to say something
about
that.
Yeah, well, if we're trying to live and work from our sweet spot, our greatest source of both ease and strength is other people. If we've learned anything from the last 100 years or longer of research on well-being, our overall well-being, what we learn is that a person's well-being, happiness, is best predicted by how connected they are to the people around them. So that's why I dedicated a whole section of the book to how to feel more connected in a really practical way. And when we aren't feeling so connected, how we can repair those relationships. It's just our most powerful source of positive emotions
yeah.
and lots of things.
And I think it's important, too, to know that our temperaments are so different and that there are people who are, you know, more introverted
or
don't want to be in relationship all the time and how important it is to respect that. And just as Noemi was saying, how different we all are.
Yeah, absolutely. It's not, I'm not saying you'll only be in the sweet spot if you go to more parties.
Right.
Right?
Right.
We all have different ways of being in relationship, but we human beings tend to be very clannish, very tribal. Yes. Our nervous systems tend to function more efficiently when we are with other people because we feel safe. And that's not true for everyone, of course, but
in
for
general,
most people do better when we do these little things, when we make more eye contact, when we give and receive more hugs, when we, you know, so there's, you know, lots of things we can do. Yeah.
Let's try and fit in one more call here. We have Chris on the line with us. Hi, Chris.
Hi. I just want to speak to especially women who so many of us are just trained to be like busy bees taking care of the
mm-hmm.
universe. And
yes.
I was in the helping professions as a nurse and, you know, just kept chugging along. And I remember getting in the elevator and just as the doors would open, I would say to myself sometimes out loud, okay, showtime. Because I had to put on my game face. I had to suck it up and do whatever I had to do. I was mentally, like, crossing off days on the calendar till I could retire. Didn't have any idea how stressed I was and want to speak to the thing about burnout with women and, like, how far you can go down the road with that. I ended up having to take early retirement because I became so profoundly depressed. And actually, I don't think the people at my job ever even knew why I left. I just wasn't there one day and never came back.
Thank you for bringing this up. I think there are a lot of people who can relate to what you're saying. I know I left as an executive director because I was burnt out as well. Chris?
Yeah, well, you know, what I would say is learn from our mistakes, right? So that, and the reason that I wrote this book was so that I wouldn't get quite that far. I could see that I was on that same path. But also, we have the tools for recovery from this. They're sometimes very surprising. You know, there's a whole chapter on being more courageous, right? How exactly to be courageous? Because this is hard to diverge from, especially for women, the expectations, the massive expectations.
Right. And I think, Chris, my guess is if we had more time, you would also say that you've learned a lot about how you don't have to put on that happy face in order to live a good life. So I'm going to have to leave it at that for now, but I hope you'll call in again sometime. You're in Monterio. That's great. So we'll talk to you again. Christine Carter. Do you ever get Chrissy? Sometimes people call you Chrissy.
No, Christy. Yeah, my mom.
Christine Carter from the Greater Good Science Center. It's a pleasure to talk to you today. It's just absolutely a pleasure.
Oh, thank you. It's really a pleasure to be here.
Yeah, and The Sweet Spot, How to Find Your Groove at Home and at Work is a book that you can find in bookstores. I want to tell you about April 15th is KPFA's 66th birthday. I'm supposed to let you know because it's important if you want to help celebrate. You can donate to KPFA, their AIR Indiegogo campaign. This campaign, if it's successful, will be able to shorten the number of days that the on-air fundraising goes. So go to kpfa.org and click the link at the top of the page. And thanks to all of you who have kept KPFA going strong for the last 66 years. So I'll be back on April 27th. But in the meantime, you can reach me at my website at nurserona.com. Dr. Lenora will be back on air next Monday, and you can also listen to all the archives at kpfa.org. My gratitude to our board operator, Wes Burton, and our producer, Felix. May we all live with peace and with ease. Thank you all, and have a great day.
everyone. This is Mitch Jezerich at KPFA. Want to let you know that our radio station has launched an Indiegogo campaign to try to raise $100,000 for improvements to our building. Now, over the past 24 years, while we have been covering and talking about historic moments in political life, racial tensions, economic inequality, war, and peace, our building has taken a real beating, and we just haven't had the funds to repair it. And now we're close to the breaking point. So we're asking you for your help so that we can update our studio equipment, repair our tattered offices that are in need of paint, new rugs, and last but not least, replace our elevator. So please join KPFA's community building campaign. Here's how you can help. Go to our website, kpfa.org, and click the link to our Indiegogo video. Then please donate. No amount is too small. So please help this historic and precious community radio station stay right here in the heart of the San Francisco Bay Area.
And you're listening to 94.